introduction to the oscilloscope lab. This is the function generator which outputs the signal. This is the oscilloscope which will measure the signal. We will be using a BNC cable, also known as a coaxial cable. Connect one end of the cable to channel 1, or channel A, or X. Be sure to push in and give it a turn so it clicks into place. If it's not clicked into place well, you may get a bad signal. The other end, put it onto the output of the function generator. Turn the oscilloscope on, and then just wait for it to boot up. It is a good idea to press the default setup button . The oscilloscope boots up with the settings of the previous user, and you don't know what those were. Now turn on the function generator using the power button. At this point, you should see a signal, but if you don't, try twisting the trigger knob. More on the trigger knob later. If you still don't see a signal, call your instructor over. There are four buttons on the function generator down here. For anything we're doing, they should just be in the off position. Off is out. These three buttons control the type of waveform that is being output. The first one outputs a sine wave, or what's called AC current. The second one is called a square wave, which we will use to mimic an open and closed switch in the RL and RC circuit labs. The last one is a sawtooth wave, which we won't be using in our labs. Select a sine wave for this lab. The function generator is being used to create a signal that we want to measure, and the oscilloscope is the tool we are using to measure it. This row of buttons at the top is what we use to select the range of frequencies that we want to work in. We're going to start with 500 Hz. Then we're going to use these knobs to adjust the exact output frequency that we want. There's a coarse knob and a fine knob. In the video, the number on the display is hard to read. That's just a function of the digital nature of the camera and the function generator. But in real life, it should look stable. You can adjust the output voltage with this knob on the function generator. Once we have set up the frequency and voltage here on the function generator, we don't want to change it because we want to learn to use the oscilloscope to read that, and it wouldn't make sense to change it in the middle of our reading. This knob selects the scale for reading voltage. It is set in units of volts per division. Adjusting this knob to a lower setting causes the signal to be displayed bigger on the screen. This knob is used to adjust the time scale. It is set in units of time per division. Changing to a higher setting will cause more cycles to be displayed on the screen. Basically, the oscilloscope creates a graph of the signal, where the vertical axis is the voltage and the horizontal axis is the time. The zero of voltage is also called the ground, and it is represented by a little voltage symbol here on the edge of the graph. This knob adjusts where the ground is displayed on the vertical axis. It adjusts the zero for the voltage axis. Selecting this button opens up the trigger menu. The source is selected, channel 1 coming in from that cable, source 1, channel 1. The trigger tells the oscilloscope when to start drawing. It always wants to start drawing the signal at the same place so that it draws over itself and looks stable on the screen. At the top of the screen is an orange triangle. The trigger level is a voltage. The voltage level that the trigger is set to is the voltage that you will see the signal at under the orange triangle on this particular scope. If the trigger level is raised above the voltage of the signal, then it doesn't know when to start drawing the signal, and you get an unstable signal, or on some scopes, no signal at all. This button selects the measurement menu. When you press the measurement menu button, by default, two measurements show up on the screen. One is the frequency, and the other is the peak-to-peak voltage. That's the voltage measured from the top to the bottom of the signal. On this modern scope, we could just read the values that we want directly from the screen, but I'm going to show you how to calculate the frequency and the voltage. As I change the time scale, I change the number of seconds per division. The actual value for number of seconds per division is written here on the top of the screen. It is often a very small number involving microseconds or nanoseconds per division. One division is one of these little boxes, either up, down, or sideways. You can't really see in the video, but you'll be able to see on your scope in front of you. As I change the volts per division, the signal takes up different amounts of space on the screen. I can get the reading for the setting for volts per division up here on the screen. Without having this number to read the voltage, I can still calculate it. I would normally adjust the ground to where the top or bottom of the signal is lined up with one of the lines on the oscilloscope. And then I would just count the number of divisions from bottom to top and multiply it times the volts per division to get my signal. It should be equal to that number after I do that. To measure the frequency, I want to know where my zero, my average value, is for the voltage. I want to know my ground line. I put it at some convenient line on the oscilloscope. I want to stretch out the signal in time as far as I can, and yet I still want to have at least one whole wave on the oscilloscope. This setting is less than a whole wave, and there's a whole wave. This knob adjusts the time, or basically moves the signal left or right. I'm going to adjust it so that it crosses the zero line on the way up. It's some convenient vertical line. Here it crosses the zero going up, and here it crosses the zero going up, and I count the number of divisions between those two spots. Multiply times the time per division up above. That will give me the period of the wave. Divide by 1 over the period to get the frequency, and the frequency should match this number right here.